Good evening, everybody. I know why you're here, so I won't be long. Let me just say you're in the church tonight, and it is our great pleasure, as Brother Larry has said, through the Board of Deacons of this church, to join with the People's Organization for Progress to host this session tonight. You may applaud. There's all kinds of evidence of providence in the house. Let me just say this scheduled program was for February, yes? My wife and I were out of the country, and I'd given my regrets to Brother Larry that I would not be able. I had communicated that to my brother, Cornel West. So we were just resigned to missing what we knew would be a wonderful opportunity to hear from arguably the most insightful philosopher in the Western world. And so it snowed. I made the unpardonable error of sending a picture to the church of Mrs. Howard and myself dressed in short pants. I won't do that again. But it was snowing so bad that the program couldn't go forward. And in the interim, Brother Cornel, Larry was up too late one night roaming around in the city as he does tirelessly every day, and he was hit by a car in his car and was quite seriously injured. And this is an opportunity now on this evening to enjoy the presentation and the fellowship, to demonstrate our support for POP and the great work it does, but also to thank God for returning whole to us. Cornel West is a very busy man, but when Lawrence Ham asked him to come, he doesn't skip a beat. That's not because Larry has thousands of dollars. Maybe Larry is not because Larry has $1,000. Because Cornel West knows Larry Ham, and he knows his commitment to the struggle. He knows that he's a serious man who asks no one to go where he's not already been. Yes, sir. So this is also a celebration, and that's why I say it's providential. I welcome you to Bethany, and let me say there is a price for being here. You're going to be asked to give some money to support the People's Organization for Progress. Let's get that to it. And when that time comes, I want to give you adequate warning that this receptacle in which you will be asked to place your donation has 10 in the bottom. So if you give us some metal money, it's going to rattle, and everybody will know what you did. The second thing here is that on Saturday morning, at 9 o'clock with breakfast, we're going to assemble here, and I want you to be here. There's a flyer that you can pick up. We are trying to mobilize people across the state to change laws that are inordinately hurtful to people who are economically poor. The bail laws of our state are inhumane. Thousands of people in our state are locked up right now in county jails because they can't afford $200 to get out on a $2,000 bail. You bringing me a copy, Larry?
Yes, sir.
This is the way that flyer looks. Get this. This is all the information you need, and a willing spirit. Come on out and help us reform the bail laws. We're going to have concrete assignments. This is not a teach-in. This is a mobilization for action in honor of Dr. King, who was assassinated on April 4th. So on April 5th, we come together. And let me just say that if a person who has been in jail 6 months because they can't afford $200 sees the judge, and the judge throws the case out because there's no basis for the charge, it means that that person has been enslaved for 6 months. Hello. So come and be with us. I know Pop is going to be here. If you are in sympathy or in support of what Pop is about, I hope you too will come, and we will all be blessed by your presence. Again, let me thank you. And now I'm going to invite Deacon Carl Watson, a prominent deacon in this church, to come forward and offer an opening prayer. Brother Watson.
God, first of all, we thank you for allowing us to breathe the air of this world on this day. And then, God, we thank you for giving us the privilege, the opportunity to come out and share this evening with this great fighting organization. We thank you, dear God, for the tireless and selfless Spirit. We pray that you would continue to empower this organization so that they might continue the work that you have called them out to do. We thank you, dear God, for the fighting spirit of Larry Hand.
Yes.
Of Cornel West.
Yes.
Of a Moses William Howard. We pray, dear God, that you would keep your hand upon them. Never ever leave them to themselves. The Lord, continue to be their strength and to be their guide. And Lord, it is our prayer for all of us that you would give each and every one of us a faith that will give us the courage and compassion to live committed lives of love and service to all of you. Pray, dear God, that the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts this evening will be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Now, Brother Larry Adams has empowered me to solicit, and there's a real punitive punishment for anyone who answers the call falsely. But Brother Larry, there's a good pianist in the house who can play Lift Every Voice and Sing. And I would like to know, who is that pianist? Is there one who can do that? And let me tell you, it's gonna be severe if you lie. So if nobody's volunteering, I guess we could do this as you said. We can do it. All right, so let's stand, and you're going to have somebody lead us.
Right?
All right. Come on,
Andrew. Anybody that knows the words on the back of the program?
You do it like this.
And of course, you can.
Thank you. Welcome. Lift every voice and sing.
Let it be sad.
march on till victory is
won. Okay, I want to join the seat to welcome the leader of the People's Organization for Progress, Mr. Lawrence Hand.
We had
demonstrations in front of Nassau Hall for 66 consecutive days. And before it was over, we were having the largest demonstrations that Princeton had seen since the Vietnam War. And I'm glad to say tonight that we were victorious because Princeton did divest in some companies that did business in South Africa. But Reverend Howard and I continue that, you know, sometimes many people know me as a militant materialist, but sometimes I can't help but feel the hand of providence moving in events. Because I came back home to Newark, New Jersey, and I look up at what's happening with Bill Howard from Princeton is now the pastor of Bethany Baptist Church. And I said, that's good news, because we know we can help build this movement together. And Reverend Howard has been supportive of all of our efforts, even after we were out, the movement to free South Africa continued. And then our goal was to get New Jersey to divest its money from, to divest its pension funds from companies that did business with South Africa. The now deceased Assemblyman Willie Brown put the bill in. We marched on Trenton. We camped out. Reverend Howard was there with us. We camped out on the lawn of the State House. And I'm proud to say that they did divest those pension funds from companies that did business with South Africa. So Reverend Howard, Reverend Howard has been in many, many campaigns for racial, social, and economic justice. New Jersey is not known to be the most progressive state in the union, but Reverend Howard, through his leadership, helped build the movement to have the death penalty abolished in New Jersey. Church is a great church with a great congregation. It opens its doors to the oppressed and the exploited. You know, Jesus asked the question, who are the least of these? And here at Bethany, they not only work with people in the community, but they also work with those who are incarcerated. This institution, this church, has programs to help those who have come out of prison, and I urge everyone to come and participate in the program. I know I'm going to be there Saturday morning at 9 o'clock to reform laws here in this state. We need to change the criminal justice system, not only in this state. Tonight, we are here with Dr. Cornel West. I just want to also say that April 4th marks the anniversary of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King. And we must keep in mind that Martin Luther King did not die a natural death. He did not die in his sleep. He was the victim of forces of oppression and reaction, embodying a program called COINTELPRO that sought to eliminate black leadership, to prevent the rise of anyone who could unite not only the masses of black people, but the masses of everybody in this country that wants a better society. He was assassinated to stop that movement. But I'm here tonight to say that although Dr. King is dead, his spirit continues to hold us up. It continues to fight for this situation. The assassination of Dr. King reminds me of my own mortality, which I came face to face with on Tuesday, March the 4th. I was driving through Newark, driving south on 18th Street,
when I came through the intersection of 18th Street and 15th Avenue, I was hit by a stolen car. Unfortunately, young brothers, juveniles from our community, stole the car and hit me right on the driver's side. The impact was so great that it spun the car around and literally pushed the car up on the sidewalk. They had to cut the roof of the car off and cut the driver's door off to get me out of the car. And I remember when they were pulling, after they had pulled the roof of the car off, I could only look up at the sky. And for the first time in my life, the stars seemed so close. The sky felt so near. And I had confronted death before, brothers and sisters. But I had to ask the question, God, is this it? And I was really concerned. On the way to the ambulance, after I got to the hospital, they said, Mr. Ham, you have 17 broken ribs. You have a broken hand, a collapsed lung, lacerated liver, and a punctured spleen. Doesn't look good. But the good news is that I come from a community that prays. Moment that people heard that I was in the hospital, they were coming to the University of Medicine and Dentistry. When they took me into the operating room that night, people followed me on the gurney down to the operating room. And I imagine if they could, they would have went into the operating room with me. And I don't want to call names, because if I start calling names, then I'm gonna forget somebody, and somebody's gonna feel offended. But I just wanna say to everybody here tonight who came to the hospital, who sent cards, who had me in their prayers, I thank you with all my heart and soul, because I know I stand here tonight just a little more than 3 weeks later because of your love and your prayers.
Country. And we need an organization and a movement
tonight, not just to come out tonight, but come out night after night after night and be a part of the day-to-day effort for social transformation. That's what we need. I met Brother Cornel West some years ago. I actually heard about him before I met him. And I'm not talking about recently. I heard about him when he was at the campus that Achille and myself and Larry Adams and others, where we went to school, Princeton University. Yes, Princeton University. They are people who can go to Princeton and come back home and work for social justice. Brother Cornel West's reputation precedes him. You can read about his particular accomplishments in the program that you have. His bio is there. But let me say something about the Cornel West that I know personally. Years ago, Paul Robeson said, the artist must elect to fight for freedom or support the forces of reaction. Cornel West is an intellectual who has not remained in the academic ivory tower.
That's right.
He is in the tradition of W.E.B. Du Bois. He is in the tradition of Carter G. Woodson. He is an intellectual that has taken his great talents and his mind and put those things in the service of the people, in the service of the movement that wants peace and social justice. And that is why we love him so much. He is an intellectual that not only writes, but strives to synthesize his thought and his practice. He is an intellectual that is not only at book signings, but is an intellectual on picket lines. He's not only an intellectual that gives lectures, but is an intellectual that is in sit-ins and gets arrested for just social causes. That's the kind of intellectual that we need in our community. Him to speak on a particular topic tonight. We asked him to speak on organization and resistance in the struggle for black liberation. We discussed and thought long and hard. This was supposed to be a program that was going to take place on February 1st, the first day of Black History Month. And in pop, we discussed for a long time, what is it that we need to do? What is it that Brother West should address? And the question that came to us was the question of power. Our community is under attack.
Yes.
Our people are under attack. Oppressed and exploited people of all races are under attack. The majority of people in this country are under attack. And the question is, how do we build the fight back to defend our interests and defend our interests? This is the question that must be addressed. They're closing our schools. They're foreclosing our homes, closing our libraries, closing the factories, closing the post offices. How much do they have to close before we say enough is enough? How much? They continue to do it because they have not yet met the countervailing force that can stop them from doing it. The question we ask our great public intellectual, Dr. West, to address tonight is how do we build this countervailing force so that when they close our schools, we have not a demonstration of 200, but a demonstration of 2,000. When they engage in unjust wars, how do we have not only a march on Washington, but marches in major cities simultaneously all around the country to let them know that the majority of people do not want war, we want peace. How do we build a movement to save our young men who are filling up the jails and prisons of this country? How do we build a movement that can make a better life for our children so that they can enjoy the opportunities that we have but are being taken away from us? This is the question that we face, and this is the question that now Brother Cornel West will address. Thank you, brother, for coming up.
My dear brother, our dear brother Larry Ham, still on fire. Year after year, decade after decade, it's true. We go back almost 35 years, and he was saying the same thing in terms of clarity of vision, in terms of depth of his analysis, but most importantly, in terms of his courage. He has been a long distance runner, and he's still running. A beautiful thing. Give it up one more time for our brother. God bless you, brother. God bless you. I'm just so blessed to stand here. That was about 4 years ago. I was blessed to stand here. We celebrated the 10th anniversary of our very dear brother, one of the most significant visionary leaders in contemporary Christendom, right here in not just Newark, but on the chocolate side. Bethany Baptist Church, historic institution, consecrated by so many folk coming through Sunday after Sunday, staying close to the blood at the cross to be transformed in order to bear witness. I'm talking about Reverend Dr. M. Howard Jr., who is my dear brother. I've known him now for almost 45 years. Can you believe that? His brother made history when he was head of the National Council of Churches. National Council of Churches, 30 years old. Straight out of Princeton. Straight out of America's Georgia, Jim Crow gut bucket, Georgia he came from. And Morehouse College. And he's still a long distance runner. Oh, we've got some significant and magnificent folk here in this city. Richard Roper, my God, where is Brother Roper? Where is he? He's so humble. Oh, there he is. There he is. Stand up, brother. Stand up. Get his brother a hand. Not just head of deacon board, one of the visionary leaders. Knew him at Princeton too. We have a special brothers meeting. Sometimes the brothers need to steal away, you know. We have a meeting every month where we steal away with Bill Howard and Richard Roper, Brother Peter Harvey, one of the finest legal minds. He was the first black attorney general in the history of New Jersey from Morgan State and Columbia University. He's on his way here tonight. And Eddie Glaude, who's a young brother, intellectual brother. He and I were just together at a PhD exam where we had the 16th black graduate student come out of the Department of Religion. We produced over 75% of all the black graduate students in Princeton. That's one department. But that's Eddie Glaude. Got a book coming out called Democracy in Black. And then our brother Larry was kind enough to come along, and we spent a little time together too. And I say that because we need networks, you need friends, and when you intensify your dance with mortality like so many of us, we all getting closer to physical death. I come to my physical desk with a smile on my face because I'm going to go down swinging. swinging. My body gonna be so used up that even the worms gonna look at it and say, oh my God. What has this Negro been through? What's this black man been through? And I'm serious about that. I'm very serious about that, because one of the reasons why it's difficult to build the kind of organization, by organization we mean three things. We're talking about your vision and the courage behind your vision, your analysis. Do you really understand what you're up against? Do you understand the economy, the nation state, its relation to corporate media, and the reason why there's so much sleepwalking in the country? And then the organizing and mobilizing that has to take place. Yeah, we're going to talk about all of that tonight. But I want to begin on a note of gratitude, because I am who I am because somebody loved me. Somebody cared for me, and I'll never forget it. Never forget all of that sacrifice, all of that service that went in to the shaping of this crack vessel named Cornel West. Irene, my mama, and Clifton West, the daddy who's gone. My brother Clifton and my sister Cynthia and Cheryl. My son Cliff and my daughter. I apologize for being late because I had to pick her up from school today. And we had some serious traffic. She's here in the church doing her homework because she got 3 hours of homework. She's heard me speak 150 times. I told her I had something distinctive today to say. She said, oh, really? But it's a blessing for her to be part of what the Isley brothers call a caravan of love. And that's exactly what it is. And you looked at Larry Ham standing there. He's not just intellectual, he's not just freedom fighter, he's part of the caravan of love. And it's a caravan of love of a people who've been taught to hate themselves. I was blessed to write a song with a genius named Bootsy Collins. We wrote a song called Freedom, F-R-E-E-D-U-M. When love is a threat, that what happens to a people who have been taught to hate themselves, so unloved and uncared for, especially young folk, and when they encounter love, the first response is one of fear. It constitutes a threat because they're not used to being loved like that. Oh, yes. And you see, look at the history of black people. It's the history of that caravan of love trying to get folk to wake up from their sleepwalking, because they've been normalizing the thinking that love is so isolated and so rare and so atypical. That's why when Huey Newton stood in front of the police, they put the gun to his head and said, you can kill me, I'm willing to die for the people. Black folks said, this Negro's crazy. Never been loved like that, the way Nat Turner and Harriet Tubman and the way Sojourner Truth, the way Marcus Garvey, the way Malcolm X, the way Fannie Lou Hamer, the way Stokely Carmichael, the way Diane Ruhr, and the way Donnie Hathaway, and the way Curtis Mayfield, and the way Shirley Caesar and James Cleveland love a people taught to hate themselves. Well, I want to begin by invoking one of the great figures in the caravan of love, the love train that the OJs sang about. And it is W. Du Bois. Anytime we raise those kind of crucial questions, you got to invoke the Sankofa birds. Oh, you got to look back to be in contact with the best of those who came before to empower you to move forward, which means you have to have a sense of history. You affirm the three dimensions of time, the past, the present, and the future. So glad to see my dear brother Glenn Ford here. Stand up, brother Glenn. Love this brother. Respect this brother. Black Agenda Report, telling the truth, laying bare, exposing the lies, trying to keep the love train alive. Du Bois was 89 years old when he put pen to paper and wrote these words. He had already been put before the U.S. court. They had him in handcuffs just 5 years earlier because he was trying to eliminate nuclear weapons around the world. because he was engaging in critiques of the American empire, and most importantly because he was making connections between the vicious legacy of white supremacy and the inability of capitalism to deal with the problems of poor people. That's Du Bois. What does he have to say? 89 years old. He said, I want to write a trilogy. I want to write three novels. Can you imagine that? 89 years old. Next project, three novels. That's what he did. He turned to page 275 in that first novel, The Ordeal of Mansart. He said, there's four questions I've been wrestling with all of my life, directly connected to the issue of organization and resistance and the struggle for liberation of a precious and priceless chocolate people, black people, African people in the new world. Du Bois said the first question is, how does integrity face oppression? How does integrity face oppression? Second query, what does honesty do in the face of deception? Honesty in the face of deception. The third query, what does decency do in the face of insult? And that last query, how does virtue meet brute force? So those are the four queries I've been wrestling with. And he's saying in part, there will never ever be an awakening among a sleepwalking people until the issues of what it means to have integrity and honesty and decency and virtue are thoroughly not just affirmed but are enacted and embodied. These days, it's hard to find folk with integrity. We live in a context where everybody's up for sale. And everything is up for sale. You can call it commodification, marketization, commercialization. Too many churches believe the kingdom of God is a brand. So the blood at the cross becomes Kool-Aid, that thin stuff that can't sustain you. So you end up with churches that are mega churches but no mega courage. Oh, it's true. True. You end up with churches whose building fund is breaking every record but their prison ministry is hardly working on the ground. Thank God for Bethany Baptist. But the blood is still flowing. Instead of integrity, you get cupidity. Love of money. Wu-Tang Clan said, cream. Cash rules. Everything around me. So good to see you. I kill it, my dear sister. So good to see you. Cash rules, but it doesn't have to rule me. What we love about those who constitute wind at our back is that they had an absolute commitment to integrity that would hold cupidity at arm's length. Yes, we all need money. Yes, we need cash flow. But when that money and that cash flow begins to determine what you're saying, what you're doing, who you are, that's a form of idolatry. No people can survive. Especially a black people can't survive by succumbing to cupidity. And we got too many leaders, politically, economically, religious, intellectually, who are just selling their souls for a mess of pottage because they're so obsessed with some fleeting visibility. As if that's what the people going to talk about at their funeral, as opposed to what kind of human beings they are and what kind of witness did they bear and what kind of service did they render. You got to be old school in part because it has a historical backdrop. And our market economy eliminates the history and the past so that the very notion of there being a vision connected to integrity beyond just money, money, money is hard to conceive of. You can't have organization, my brother, without that deep sense of history, that connection, that bond, that source of empowerment. But we living in a moment in which cupidity and venality, and venality simply means I'm a candidate for bribery. Try me. And I'm not just talking about all the scandals in business and politicians and so forth. Obsession with the 11th commandment, thou shalt not get caught. That's what we're dealing with across the board. Why? Because the corruption is so ubiquitous and it's hard to hold it at arm's length, let alone to follow the Negro National Anthem, which is to say what? Not lift every echo, but lift every voice. How many real voices do we have left in the country? How many echoes? Turn on your television and see. Fox News, right-wing propaganda. MSNBC, neoliberal propaganda. Where are the voices? It's like looking for Donny Hathaway and getting Millie Vanilli. Don't tell me what you're imitating. What are you creating? I don't want to see copies. I want to see originals. Where are the originals? Brother James, so good to see you. We just did Rahway part of our course. I'm blessed to teach a course at Rahway on Fridays, every third Friday, 150 brothers. In philosophy, oh, we have a good time. It was just there this past Friday, wrestling with Lorraine Hansberry and Plato and so forth. You right there wrestling with it too. It's so good to see you, Brother James. And oh, those brothers, they understand the need for voices because too many of them followed echoes and hit up against the dead end. And too many of them got caught for soft drugs and ended up in jail. Whereas those Wall Street executives who embezzled billions of dollars of insider trading, market manipulation, fraudulent activity, they sipping tea in the Congress, White House, and in the nightclub. He just had a brother Diamond the other day at Howard. I was blessed to preach at Howard on Sunday. And he was at Howard just right before me, giving this big degree saying he expressed the core values of Howard University. I said, which Howard University are you talking about? You're talking about Sterling Brown? Are you talking about Toni Morrison? Are you talking about Stokely Carmichael? Which Howard are you talking about? I love Howard University. I love Negro institutions. I love Negroes, hot dang it. And that's very important because too many of our leaders and spokesfolk love everybody but black people. Black folk just an afterthought. Oh, yeah, you're there, aren't you? No, you start on the chocolate side of town. Not because you're tribalistic or exclusivistic, but because your mom and daddy is chocolate. And your grandmother's chocolate. And if you don't learn to love them right, then you ain't gonna love nobody right. Even your love of the vanilla brothers and sisters. Vanilla brothers and sisters deserve all the love, yes, but your love of them will just be imitation and manipulation. Won't have any authenticity whatsoever if you ain't loving your own folk first. You don't need to apologize for that. You wouldn't even be here if it wasn't for that black love. How come black love is still viewed as somehow some tertiary phenomenon? One reason why Nelson Mandela was so loved, Martin Luther King Jr. so celebrated. You look at the news, you think the reason why they went to jail is because they were forgiving white brothers and sisters. No, they went there because they loved black people. And the love for black people spilled over to forgiveness to vanilla brothers and sisters. But the vanilla brothers and sisters were not center stage. Martin Luther King Jr., they put him in a paddy wagon in October 1960. Didn't tell them where they were going. Put a German shepherd in there, just him and a German shepherd in pitch dark
for 5 hours. Brother Andy Young told me when Martin got out, it was just he and Daddy King waiting there at Reedville Prison in Tatnall County in Gut Bucket, Jim Crow, Georgia. Looked like Martin had a nervous breakdown. He only had one sentence in his mouth. This is the cross we must bear for the freedom of our people. That's all he had to say. That's all he had to say. That's real. That's authentic. Doesn't make him a god or a deity. The brother had been loved in such a way that he understood that he can love by somehow being part of that caravan of love, and therefore he was willing to organize, clarify his vision, sharpen his analysis, and most importantly, to pay a price, not a market price, a moral, a spiritual, a political price. That's why June 26, 1964, he called Malcolm X. We know because it's on the FBI file. Shoot. You look at Claiborne Carson's books, Malcolm X, FBI file. Martin Luther King, FBI file. June 26, 1964, Martin calls Malcolm. March the 12th, Malcolm broke from the Nation of Islam. No Malcolm without the love of Elijah Muhammad. But out of love and critique, he has to break. March the 26th, they're shaking hands in front of the Capitol. June 21, three of our courageous freedom fighters in the South were killed. It was Sherman and Cheney and Goodman. And Malcolm had announced, we're going to the United Nations. We're going to put the United States on trial for the violation of human rights of black people. I invite all organizations to join me. Martin Luther King Jr. calls. What kind of history would we have had if they had got together? We need to talk about that moment. 3 days later, they tried to poison the food in Malcolm's plate. And he's on to Africa. They never got a chance to hook up. But don't ever think that when you're talking about folk who fall in love with a people, I didn't say an abstraction, I didn't say even some kind of ideal, I'm talking about with a people. Fall in love with a people, you hate the fact they're being treated unjustly. You loathe the fact they're being treated unfairly. And if you don't do something, the rocks are gonna cry out. That's what we're talking about when you're talking about organization among a people who have been downtrodden for so long, sleepwalking for so long, but hungry and thirsty for something more, but it's not available in the mainstream media. It's not available in the corporate media. Martin Luther King Jr. wrote a little note. Exactly 46 years ago, it was a day and a half before he was shot in Memphis. He said, I want to preach Ebenezer on Sunday. He never got a chance to preach that sermon. The name of that sermon was Why America May Go to Hell. That's not Jeremiah Wright. That's not our dear brother Jeremiah Wright. That's Martin Luther King Jr. He didn't say America ought to go to hell. Didn't say America should go to hell. He said America may go to hell. Why? Because he had said America is a major conveyor of violence in the world. The major violator of international law in the world. He said, and I know the FBI has already said that I am the most dangerous man in America. That's a lie. I'm not the most dangerous man. The most dangerous force, the awakening of the people. The most dangerous force is when vision, analysis, and organization among a hated people, when a rage is transformed into a righteous indignation, almost like Jesus in the temple running out the money changers in Jerusalem. And that temple, of course, was the equivalent of White House, Congress, Wall Street, and Hollywood. Oh, that's the kind of Jesus we're talking about. Oh, yes. Out of what? Love for the least of these. The poor, the prisoner, the elderly, the fatherless, the motherless, the children, working people, all folk who've been spit on, all folk who've been devalued,
Yes, that kind of fire. So fundamental for any kind of organizational renaissance.
Now, I do hope we get not just 1,000, but 2,000 folk to join People Organization for Progress. Oh, yes. Ain't no doubt about that. You need numbers. You need resources. But in the end, it's not just about numbers. You got to have the right kind of folk in there. If they're not on fire and they're lukewarm, it doesn't make any difference what your quantity is. It's still a low drag. You got to have folk who are willing to move, committed, full of convictions. But most importantly, you have to have folk who have a commitment to honesty. And that's the second theme that the great Du Bois was talking about. We live in an age of monstrous mendacity. Lies everywhere. Everywhere. And hyper-hypocrisy. And I'm talking also about ourselves. I'm not talking about just pointing fingers. All of us are cracked vessels now. We're walking contradictions. But we ought to be honest about it. We ought to be candid about it. I can't get over all this talking Ukraine and Crimea and so forth. America acting like we've got such moral authority of a nation violating international law. Please, please, get off your symbolic crack pipe and tell the truth about yourself. Invading, occupy Iraq, 1 million people dead, violation of international law. Invade, occupy Afghanistan, violation of international law. What about Grenada? What about Panama? We can go on and on and on. What about Saudi Arabia and Bahrain? Come on, America, do you think that we sleepwalking forever? Yes, we concerned in international law, but let's start at home. Don't be so hypocritical. My God. We got 40% of black, brown, and red children living in poverty in the richest nation in the history of the world. That's morally obscene and spiritually profane. 20% of all of America's children living in poverty in the richest nation in the history of the world. Thank God for Pop. We see the moral outrage and righteous indignation and holy anger. Where else do you see it? Thank God for Philip Harper and the Dream Defenders, younger generation, hungry and thirsty for more than just that superficial stuff. Young folk are tired of being told, we want you to be highly successful so you can have material toys and be well adjusted to injustice. You think Ella Baker lived her life with such integrity and honesty so that she could produce just some successful Negroes? No, she wanted folk to use their success to be faithful to something bigger than them. Don't just be smart. Let the phones be smart. Be wise and courageous and compassionate. Thank God for the Dream Defenders. They say, yes, we want to be part of that tradition. We don't want to just be successful. And that's what it is in the age of Obama. Everybody wants to look up and see who are the successful black folk rather than look down and see who's stuck in the basement. Don't tell me about the glass ceiling that you're breaking, unless you break in some convention in order to bear witness to a truth and some organizing that will have impact on the least of these. End up with a whole generation of peacocks. Look at me, I'm so successful. I'm somebody, I'm so smart, I'm so articulate, I'm so eloquent. You can hear Muddy Waters from Mississippi saying, peacocks strut because they can't fly.
No, no, we come from a tradition of eagles who fly high and look low and lift as we climb, because whatever success and spiritual and intellectual weaponry we have, we render it to something bigger than us. It's the kingdom of God if you're a Christian like me. If Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to you, then you already on the love train like me. But everybody don't have to be a Christian. Could be Muslims like Malcolm. Could be agnostics like James Baldwin. Could be a whole host of other kind of folk. We Christians have no monopoly on integrity and honesty. Given the history of Christianity and its complicity with structures of domination and hatred against our Jewish brothers and sisters, or against our Muslim or Arab brothers and sisters, but there's some prophetic Christian folk who hold on and hold out. Thank God for Bethany Baptist. Thank God for Bethany Baptist. But it's telling those truths. 1% of the population owns 42% of the wealth and counting. 1% of the population got 95% of all the income growth in the last 4 years. That's a key sweat moment. Something just ain't right. It is. It's sick. It's pathological. It's a form of spiritual malnutrition and moral constipation. Because some of those folk at the top, they know what's right, but the greed is just blocking the flow. And who suffers? The precious weak and vulnerable, disproportionately black, brown, and red. But where are the voices? Well, got our brother William Barber, he needs to critique Democratic Party as well as the Republican Party, but he's on the move. He's got folk now trying somehow to wake up. Very important, but it's going to be complicated, especially trying to forge new kinds of vision and analysis with organizations in place, with a corporate media that makes it so difficult for the kind of voices of a Larry Ham to be heard constantly, constantly, constantly. Corporate media generates massive weapons of distraction by design. That's why there's no critique of the drones that has dropped bombs now on over 4,000 precious human beings and 230 innocent children. Those are war crimes coming out of the U.S. government. It's wrong, it's unjust, it's immoral. Those are war crimes. Both parties, bipartisan consensus, remain silent. You get a right-wing brother like Rand Paul has a filibuster for 13 hours because he's concerned that U.S. government has killed 4 American citizens with no accountability, no responsibility at all, given the new laws. The National Defense Act, well, you can detain folk without trial. You can assassinate folk with no responsibility. You see, that's in place now, in place under the present administration. That's our dear brother Obama. People ask me, oh, Brother West, how come you so hard on the brother? Hey, I'm a Christian. I love everybody. At least I try to. I pray for the brother and his precious family. I don't want any harm to come his way. But he's responsible for his deed. And he's in a position where he could actually cast a light on Wall Street crime, on imperial crimes in the form of drones, on the criminality in the criminal justice system. How much effort has he made in trying to disclose those lies and those crimes, if he has the audacity to say that he's got some relation to Martin Luther King Jr. That's my question. That's all right if he says, no, it's just me and Whitney Young. I said, okay, I understand. I love Whitney too, but Whitney's a neoliberal centrist. Always was, open about it. I like honest folk even when they're wrong. And what did Martin say to Whitney when Whitney put Martin down like a dog in his face? And Martin was a nonviolent man. He was a pacifist. He almost slapped Whitney upside his head. Andy said he had to hold Martin back. Martin had that street in him, that ghetto fabulous in him. That's why he was a Christian. He needed the Holy Ghost to hold your street. I understand that, because I was a gangster before I met Jesus, and I'm just a redeemed sinner with gangster proclivities right now. Nothing but the Holy Ghost holding me together. But what did Martin say to Brother Whitney? He said, what you say may get you a foundation grant, but it won't get you a place in the kingdom of truth. That's what Martin told Whitney Young. Why? Because he said, Martin, all this talk about organizing poor people across the board, Martin, this critique of Vietnam makes you sound like you're unpatriotic. And what did Martin say? He said, Whitney and so many others, y'all never knew me. You never knew me. I'm a cross bearer before I'm a flag waver. And that cross is about unarmed truth and unconditional love. And the condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak. I don't care who it is, and unconditional love means that my talk about loving others is translated on a structural and institutional level. The justice is what love looks like in public, just like tenderness is what love feels like in private. We're going to connect the structural and the institutional in the organizing with that militant tenderness that you hear in the voice of a David Ruffin or a Wanda Hutchison of the emotions, or the radical gentleness that you hear in a William Hart of the Delphonics, or a Donald McPherson of the Main Ingredient. He the one before Cuba. Tenderness, gentleness, sweetness. That's part of the caravan of love that goes into connecting unarmed truth and unconditional love, even at it is part of a political militancy. Because when you confront a system that either buys off your leaders, murders your leaders, lies on your leaders, or kills them, the freest persons are always those who have an absolute commitment to integrity and decency and are willing to go under. That's the major fundamental challenge. And in the last 30 years with this class war from above, oligarchs and plutocrats, Wall Street banks and corporate elites, war against working people, war against trade union movement, war against wages, profits going up, wages stagnating, masses of wealth transferred from poor and working people to the well-to-do, corporations paying less and less taxes, $2.4 trillion right now, corporations offshore so they will never ever pay taxes. Taxes shift to working people and the middle class, and the poor rendered more and more socially abandoned and economically neglected with very limited options. And then the spiritual blackout that we see more and more, in which there's self-disrespect, self-destruction, self-violation, self-flagellation, especially among our young folk, especially among our precious young brothers. And in part because those young brothers who we see all the time in Rahway and other places, Bordentown and others, they tend to be the warriors, but they got the wrong venue and they got the wrong channel. You see, they tend to be the courageous ones, They're the ones who willing to straighten up their backs. But the problem is that with lack of serious love and care, lack of education in decrepit school systems, with those school systems now being viciously attacked, privatized, with profiteers coming in, closing public schools, trying to make big money on public education, leaving more and more and more behind. You see, they have very little access to the sense of who they are as a people, a sense of their history. Their energy's high. Their vision is very, very narrow. Their courage is intense, but their love potion is low. And they're full of revenge. And they're full of a lot of hatred because they've been hated so. And that would be true for any peoples of any colors. To have to deal with those circumstances, those conditions, and come out of a history of a people who have been wrestling with trying to love ourselves since the first African stepped off that slave ship in 1619. And that's one of the reasons why what? That when it comes to big money, we always find it when it comes to prisons and war. It comes to jobs with a living wage? No. It comes to education? No. Healthcare? No. But we got a budgetary crisis. Well, we notice that your budgetary crisis is secondary and tertiary when it comes to this carceral state, this new Jim Crow, this prison industrial complex. You come up with the money. You want to put them right in the community now. That's war priority. And you always find it for war. You see how quick Congress came up with billions of dollars to support Ukraine in the last few days? Wasn't that something? What about Detroit? Not a penny. Not a penny. Not a dime. Wall Street in trouble. Bad choices. Bad judgment. When poor people do that, they say, pull yourselves up by your own bootstraps. You got to be responsible. You're going to be dependent on this money we're giving you. Wall Street got $787 billion. That's corporate welfare. And for 3.5 years, it got $85 billion from the Federal Reserve with near zero interest rates, and yet let some of our working class students try to go to school and get an interest, get a loan with interest rates. If they could get the same interest rates that bankers get, more of our precious children would be in school. Oh, this is how warped the situation is. But we view it as just business as usual. Oh, we need organizations that same. Based on the love. Now, you got to keep the love in it. And this is part of the problem, you see, is that so many everyday people, they seen folk who emerge as these leaders and spokespersons, but it looks like they lukewarm on the inside. That's a problem. That's a problem. And I'm not talking about perfection. I'm not talking about purity. I'm just talking about trying to have integrity in a sense of decency and honesty, being self-critical, but most importantly, putting up front the love. Doesn't have to be in language. Most importantly, it's got to be in your deeds. It's got to be in your example. And it's got to be something that you feel. Oh, yes. I tell you, one of the saddest things in popular culture for me is that for the first time last year in 50 years, we didn't have a black artist that went number one on the pop charts of Billboard. Now, can you imagine some of the most artistically sophisticated and musically refined people, going back to the spirituals, that we can't have one artist to go to the top? Robin Thicke, he's stealing from Marvin Gaye. Blurred Lines Come Right Out of Got to Give It Up. We know that. Justin Timberlake, he's fine. But ask Hall & Oates about Ted Mills and Blue Magic. Ask Hall & Oates about Junior or the Dales from Chicago. They understand, Vanilla Brothers, they're artists. What's going on with our young folk listening to bubblegum music? Very little sense of history. Bombarded every day with hedonism and materialism and trying to somehow be number one at the top just in terms of what you look like in this superficial culture of spectacle. That's what it is. Nothing but spectacle. I had a long dialogue with my dear brother Jay-Z. I said, brother, you're a lyrical genius and you're successful, but I'm still waiting to see how great you really are. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Because I come from a tradition that says, like Curtis Mayfield, like Gil Scott-Heron, like Nina Simone, you're great in terms of the quality that you render, not in terms of how many records you sell or how mainstreamed and streamlined you are. How many souls are you touching? Are you in the soul-stirring business or are you in the body-stimulating business? Let me know. That's all I want to know. That's what I want to know. And why do I talk about this? This is very important because music is the last form of transcendence for our young people, which means what? In our organizations, we got to have some musicians. Bring in Raheem Devon, and Anthony Hamilton, Kim Burrell, Angie Stone, Jill Scott. Bring them on in. We couldn't have had a movement, Brother Glenn, in the 60s without the music. There's no Martin Luther King without Mahalia Jackson. He knew that. Without Tom Dorsey's Precious Lord. Music is not ornamental or decorative. It's constitutive of who we are, who anybody is. And if we can't make that connection with our young folk, their dominant form of transcendence takes them one way, and they look at us and say, oh, those old school folk, you know, they in there talking about Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X. That's that old stuff. They waxing nostalgic. Which ain't nothing nostalgic about this. This is a vital and vibrant tradition. We're trying to keep it alive. In an age of big money and big business and big banks, we're trying to tell the truth, expose the lies, and bear witness. And it's got to connect with every sphere and every site in our lives. I used to tell my dear brother Mensa Lewis Farrakhan, I love that brother very much. We wrestle with all kind of issues and so on. But I say, the nation, given all the commitment, without music being at the center of the ritual, it's hard for me to conceive of how it's going to ever be a mass movement, my brother. And he's an artist himself. He's a fine singer himself. But of course, Elijah Muhammad, who was Reverend Elijah Poole, he was a Black Baptist minister before he became a Muslim. See, he got so upset with all of the excessive emotionalism in Black churches that became cathartic but didn't translate into struggle for justice, that when he founded his movement, he said, we ain't gonna have no music up in here. No, let the Baptists and the Pentecostals and some of the AMEZ and AME keep that music, making all that noise. And as soon as they get out there, they still cowardly, they still scared, they still intimidated. I thought they had the spirit inside of them. And that's an interesting point, though, isn't it? If you've been niggerized and Jesus doesn't de-niggerize you, what Jesus are you connected to? Who you talking about? What kind of witness you bearing? You can sing all the songs you want, but if it stays just on the surface and doesn't get inside of you and you deny yourself and pick up your cross and follow that Jesus, then what are we talking about? That's what Elijah Muhammad was talking about. Went on to become a Muslim. But the music, fundamental for young people, to give them a connection so they can have a critical vision and analysis that talks about the critique of capitalism, the critique of imperialism. Yes, and most importantly, a self-respect, a self-confidence. And there's no doubt in my mind that when the historian puts pen to paper, 150 years from now, they're going to say, lo and behold, there were a cloud of witnesses in Newark during the ice age of Reagan and Clinton. Clinton was the one, mandatory sentences. It was Clinton, of course, who signed the bill eliminating welfare. It was Clinton who deregulated markets and undercut Glass-Steagall. Oh, yes, it was Clinton. It was Clinton playing his saxophone, black folk responding with a smile, but his policies were coming at you, coming at us. But during that period, there was a People's Organization for Progress that said, oh, y'all may think that somehow we're old school, but there's a spirit of an Ameri Baraka that we'll never forget. You don't have to agree with everything he was talking about, but the fire that he had still at work in pop, still organizing and mobilizing and on the move. Oh, yes. I can't wait when his son is the mayor of the city. I can't wait. I can't wait. But that's part of a tradition that spills over. It's going to spill over into the electoral political process. But when it spills over, what does it mean? As soon as he wins, the permanent government going to be sitting there looking at him. Who is what? Corporate Newark. Corporate business Newark. Now that you won, Brother Baraka, we here forever. At least until the revolution comes. You're going to be here for a term or two. And what we going to say? We understand, we're not naive. We know that there's structural constraints, but we're gonna be there putting pressure, loving pressure, critical pressure, truth-telling pressure, witness-bearing pressure, so that he won't be alone as he presents his own policies focusing on poor and working people. We want him to be the Harold Washington of the 21st century, and that is connected to pop. It's connected to the organization. It's connected to the leadership of Larry Ham. And we're going to be there with you. Thank you all so very much. Stay strong in what you're doing.
Do you have a program?
Yes.
Who doesn't have a program?
turning to your neighbor and saying, do you have a program? You see on the program here, it says questions and answers, not statements and answers. Okay, so Brother Larry, here you are. We're going to pass the plate of the bill. Just start the plate running through the aisles. And we have a video camera. We notice everybody that's just passing the plate is doing that.
Nobody does it better. That's it. Everybody needs a free man free. So sacrifice. We will have some organization. We go from this side to this side. Please raise your hand. Be recognized by the chair. If you have a question, Brother Wes. Young brother, right there, first one I saw. Yes, sir. Identify yourself, brother. Who are you? Is there a hand mic? Yeah. Raise your hand, brother Sean. Go ahead, identify yourself. Go ahead.
My name is Justin Talbot, and I'm going to University High Charter School. And my question is, are you a black nationalist?
Oh, my dear brother. My dear brother. Thank you for that question, though, brother. Lord, no, let me see you. Where's your sparkling eyes? Yeah, there you go. Yes, indeed. Well, let me say this though, brother.
First, Brother Cornel, can we get you a hand mic so
you can I figured I had one here. Is this kicking in?
That's right.
Is this all right?
No.
Is it kicking in?
No,
that's fine. You all in?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you so much. My dear brother, yes, give you a chance right now. I'm ready to see your eyes and look at each other. Because I salute you, though, brother. You were strong in your spirit, man. I like that. But let me ask this way. First, I'm my mama's child and my daddy's child. So I'll start from the womb. I'll start from the love for your mama. Right? And as I came out, they ushered me right into Shiloh Baptist Church. And so I decided a long time ago I was going to be a revolutionary Christian. And that's what I am. Now that means, my brother, that I work very closely with certain black nationals who are progressive, who don't use any flag to downplay the role of women, the critical of sexism and patriarchy, who keep the focus on poor and working people. So I work with progressive nationals, number of progressive nationals. That's why somebody like Marcus Garvey still means so much to me. He's my comrade, Malcolm X, right out of the black national tradition. He's my big brother. Mr. Louis Farrakhan, strong man, he's my dear brother. But as a revolutionary Christian, I put the cross above every flag. Like somebody like Glenn Ford right here. Now this brother right here, and he's a serious revolutionary brother, he's a secular brother too. He puts truth and justice above every flag. Is that right, Brother Glenn? Truth and justice. So he doesn't have to be a Christian as if Christians have a monopoly on that. And that's why he and I overlap in a fundamental way. It's just that I'm a Jesus-loving free black man. He's a justice-loving free black man. And we come together. Every once in a while, we might even break off in a song. Because he's a musical brother, too. But the point is that when we say black nationalists, we always want to say, what kind of black nationalist? And then you want to define yourself from where you come from. Because all of us are working with what we got. Each and every one of us. We make choices, but we're working with what we got. And we hope that we're fundamentally committed to that truth and justice for everybody. That's true in Ethiopia, it's true in France, it's true in Brazil, it's true in Guatemala, it's true in India, all around the world. John Henry Clark is somebody whose name we need to raise up. Strong, but not confined just to those 50
five countries all around the world. Of course, he was very close to Malcolm and Martin. And of course, Mary Baraka, who Martin Luther King Jr. met the week before he died. You all know that, right? Martin came right here to Newark and said, I want to see this brother. They had a powerful, magnificent dialogue. But I appreciate that, that question from the young brother.
Somebody on this side of the house? I'm sitting there, brother.
Yeah.
Yes. And that's my brother.
How you doing?
Hi, I'm good. My name is Sasha. I'm a 21-year-old college student. I wanted to ask you, how do I get more people my age intellectually and socially involved?
Oh, wonderful question. Wonderful question, my dear sister. One is always remember that examples are the go-kart of judgment. Which is to say, you just being your brave, wonderful, courageous, visionary self, that becomes contagious. That becomes contagious. Other folks running the dead end by hanging out with other folks. Oh, your first name is?
Sasha.
So, oh, that's Sasha. She's such a grand example of integrity, honesty, and decency. I need to check that out. I tried out this other stuff and just too empty. You know, she's the real thing. And that's very, very important. That's very, very important. There's a wonderful song that was written that came out in October 1973 by two geniuses called Ashford and Simpson. And it's called Give Me Something Real That Won't Fade in the Light of Day. That's the realness, integrity, honesty, decency. This is Sasha 2014. Represent.
Folks return from the superficial.
Good evening, Dr. Owen.
My
name is Maxime Fini, and I would love to say that the basics for life itself is love. The basics for life itself is love. We believe that we need to teach that love is something when you have enough, you can give. We have to solve itself and then we will be loved. To do that, one has to accept oneself as naked without anything.
The question is,
how can we promise to everyone that we meet, we make sure they make them smile, they make them know that they are valuable. How do we can populate that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I appreciate that question, no brother. I speak just based on my own experience. I was just blessed this past week being in Smithsonian where we celebrated the 50th anniversary of John Coltrane, the Love Supreme. December 9th, 1964, right here in New Jersey, right here in the studio. Brother Coltrane and Albert Jones, Jimmy. McCoy on the piano, creating that masterpiece. It was very interesting because we were there with Chuck Stewart. Chuck Stewart is the historic photographer who took all the pictures of John Coltrane and the various albums that he made. And everybody knows John Coltrane was a saint, which is to say he was a sinner who looked at the world through the lens of his heart. And his love supreme came through 10 years of heroin addiction. Folk first met him in Philadelphia, he was a genius and a winery at the same time. Chain smoker. Over and over again, and he met a magnificent Islamic sister named Naima. Changed that brother around. And he went on to meet another genius named Alice Coltrane. Changed him around even deeper. So yes, you're right, he accepted his nakedness, but all nakedness still presupposes some antecedent condition, which is to say something prior to your nakedness. None of us are just naked all the way down. And even on your naked body, you see wounds and scars and bruises reflecting your history. So we all bring something to the table, even in our nakedness. But it's the courage to love, the courage to tell the truth, through his horn in this case. You all know his tribute to Malcolm X, his tribute to Martin Luther King Jr. You know Alabama, the classic Alabama. Telling the truth, the condition of suffering, allowing
that suffering to be manifest in its signs. So that, yes, I do agree that that love is the key. How do we get through it? Through example one, but also, for me as a Christian, you see, there's a transformation and awakening that has to take place. People awake in different ways, different forms. And in my own case, it has everything to do with making Jesus my choice. There's no doubt about it.
And I will come back every day.
First of all, I want to say that I'm very honored to be here, and I'm very inspired by words. I will tell you that you're dealing with our fire, the fire from the people. My question is, what is your position on immigration issues in the United States, especially with undocumented workers who are working every day to sustain the families? And also because, to some extent, that corporate and big companies are feeding off these people. And to many, they seem as a form of modern slavery. What is your position? What are your thoughts about it?
Well, I appreciate that, brother. We were blessed to be part of the multi-million mobilization taking place in the last 3 years. I was just actually down in El Paso a few weeks ago on the border. And of course, it's very important to keep your history in place. I'm very attached. I grew up in California. Both of them used to be Mexico. It's very interesting because Ulysses S. Grant, who fought in the Mexican War, he said this has got to be the most bogus of all wars ever fought. Because it was fought under conditions of lies, mendacity, and hypocrisy. Study the Alamo, study who Sam Houston is, the city Houston named after, and so forth. So there's a sense in which when it comes to our Chicano brothers and sisters, they're just coming home. They're just coming home. It's very important for them to think the border is something that is just so arbitrary because they know that it's just sheer power and force that dictated it to be what it is. Puerto Rico is the same way. We just had a magnificent student, Brother Oscar Lopez Rivera, who's a political brilliant, just like the mayor of Ujamaa and so many others. Puerto Rico is the same way. How did we become a colony? Violation of international law. Invaded the island after Spanish had left. But they had their own economy already. So that history is very important in terms of any discussion of contemporary policy. It doesn't dictate policy. You have to be much more detailed in your analysis in terms of where you come down. But the first thing I want to do is to ensure that the precious brothers and sisters who are here, so-called, quote-unquote, undocumented, they're not demonized, they're not dehumanized, they're not vilified, they're not scapegoated, and that you give as much attention to their children as you would give to anybody else. Include your own home very well-to-do Cornel size town. That's the spirit of the dialogue. That's the spirit of the dialogue. And so when it comes to the escalation of deportation, which is such a vicious process of ripping families apart, one has to be highly, highly critical and condemn that unequivocally. As I've tried to do on so many different occasions. So that's the beginnings of an approach to the dialogue about immigrants, and then not trying to pit new immigrants against working people. So you get a divide and conquer as the 1% at the top continue to flower and flourish. Because what we did get a chance to go into the degree to which global capitalist economy is actually looking for profits everywhere, trying to make sure that labor remains cheap, so that the profits can go up and make sure that none of those workers are in any way organized and mobilized. Be they black, brown, red, yellow, or whatever. That's the beginning of an answer to your one question.
Thank you. This is the fact. 1, 2, 3.
Hi, my name is Janet Changanuka. I was born in Nigeria, but raised here in South Orange, New Jersey. And my passion is to eventually get a law degree and a master's of public health to reform mental health. And so I'm a byproduct of a medical doctor who has been diagnosed with mental health and has been in the system here in America in the mental health system. So my question is, in terms of liberation, I know a lot of people are sleepwalking because they've been deemed mentally ill. And again, I want to be for mental health, but I want to do it with the least spirituality because I also believe in Jesus. So I want to know, what is your solution to empowering the people that are mentally health enslaved?
Yes, that's a good question. I salute your calling. Because I can just feel your spirit, meaning that it's not just a career you're after, but it is a genuine calling. That's a beautiful thing. It's a life task that you're responding to. It's not a job. So you already, like years ahead of a whole lot of folks. Because most folks just have a career and a job, and they don't know what they're here for. They have no sense of mission or purpose. All they do is want a job, career, and some Benjamin. And maybe a little pleasure. But so much of the pleasure in America, just a joyless quest for pleasure. There's no joy in it. The pleasure is insatiable, the joy is infinite. You are already beyond it. That's a beautiful thing to behold for me. What I believe we need to have major targeting. We need to make mental illness a major priority. Major priority. Because in the kind of society in which we live, when I kept talking about the flattening, the marketizing, and so forth, what you're getting is what I call spiritual malnutrition, escalating levels of depression. Yeah. Among the younger generation, 25-30% of young folks wrestling with depression every day. Every day. Why? Because they're isolated, they're not connected, they don't have bonds of trust, there's no bonds of sympathy, there's no bonds of empathy. They get a lot of body stimulation from TV, maybe on Friday and Saturday night, somebody don't know that well. That's not sustaining. I mean, it's the difference between say my name. Versus the oldest record saying what? Try a little. Mom, the presence of the teacher. Invisible. Thank God you hear from the grand people of Nigeria, don't bear witness, and you said you were Christian too. Oh, Lord Jesus. And you said you did it wrong. It's a beautiful thing. People who are non-Christian, now we're not putting you down.
Hi, my name is Sabrina Sophie Schwer. I'm very honored to be here, to have Larry Ham here among us.
Yes.
Thank you, of course. It has been my dream to see you in person. My question is tied to Africa. And how can we bridge the gap between Africa and African Americans here? As we heard, Larry Ham spoke on South Africa, how he went into struggle, recently trying to pressure oligarchies to stop investing in Africa, and how he succeeded that. But now it's like Groundhog Day, and Africa is falling under the neo-colonization policy. Chinese people, which in 2015, the number of Chinese would increase to 300 million, there would be a replacement of Africans by Chinese people. But most importantly, after the stock market crisis, Wall Street, Vanderbilt University, Princeton, Harvard, all those companies are investing on land grab. Anybody, I think you might have heard about it. Land grab is big companies by leasing for 99 years land, out of land, taking away from the indigenous people and displacing them, some of them being killed, arrested, harassed, through the African dictators who have no responsibility in taking care of their own people. Now, how do we have this struggle? I was born in Ethiopia, and we have been suffering for the last 23 years under dictatorship, in which our government here supplies with war weapons and with money over $1.2 billion a year.
What's your question again?
So that my sister that I love very much, my question is that how are we going to come together to bring systemic change, not only here,
but one, I would put it this way very briefly, that one, Africa is in many ways being colonized by China. But Africa's also being militarized by the U.S. government, the Pentagon, and the State Department. AFRICOM, like the gender report, lays out so well, keeping track of it. They say they're after terrorists. But all of the different branches now, military branches, all over Africa now, under the aegis of the United States. Why? Because there is a fight going on between China and the United States in Africa, because Africa has not only those beautiful people, laborers, but those resources. They want to gain access to it. We're talking about the big, big, big money, banks, and corporations. That's not. But the other element is, of course, so many African leaders have been willing to sell their souls for that. They are for sale, just like so many of the leaders here. Because you see, these threefold processes are global. Financialized, privatized, militarized. Financialized with big banks. You militarize with your army and your cyber space, internet, and you privatize. Which means any conception of the public, public education, public transportation, public conversation, all privatized, atomized, individualized, so that people cannot come together. What I love about POP is POP from the very beginning, based on the vision of the idea of the land, international
organization. Local in its recruitment, its organizing, international in its vision. That's why it has always been unequivocally anti-empire, anti-imperialism. That's a rare thing in the last 30 years. That's why we love this country and all of those good causes. But land defense, it really encompasses, let's just be honest about it. I mean, there's a real impending ecological catastrophe. And that raises deep questions about whether we as a species have the capacity to sustain ourselves on the globe. We might blow the whole thing out. And not us, but the folk who have more than 17,300 nuclear warheads. The United States and Russia have most of them. And only a small group of nations who had it. France, United Kingdom, and Israel. Pakistan. They could blow the whole thing up. Tonight. Tonight, that's very important to keep in mind. You got nuclear catastrophe impending, possibly, and you got ecological with the climate change, the warming, and so forth. I don't know when spring is going to finally get. Ridiculous, isn't it? But it's affected by what's in the air. You want to look at fossil fuels. So that those kinds of questions, international questions, very important.
Yeah. Last person on the stack. Sorry we can't entertain more.
Good evening, everyone.
How are you doing, everyone?
Oh, good, man.
Good. Best to be here.
My name is Rochelle. My question to you is, how do you feel the Russia stands on them outsourcing our children's education?
Yeah.
And if so, what are the side effects from years from now?
Yeah, I appreciate that question, because our dear sister Diane Ravitch, whose texts I highly recommend people to read, she says rich kids get taught and poor kids get tested. We bring in the test. Big money behind the test, pay for it, push out public spaces and public teachers. You primarily teach kids in relation to the test, which means what? Arts programs pushed to the margins. Critical reflection, expansion of imagination and intelligence and exploration, a sense of awe and wonder. What is education? Without a sense of awe and wonder and imagination and critical intelligence. But what happens at the same time? Those same three prophecies that I talked about. Because of course Wall Street is behind the private job. Big money. Moskowitz in New York. Who's behind Moskowitz? Wall Street. De Blasio understands that. We're going to see what kind of backbone he has. I support him as long as I can, but I don't want him to be another Obama. I don't want the brother to talk big and then when it comes to fighting, you milk toast. No, we can't have that. You got to keep fighting. So far, he's fighting. I appreciate that. But we don't know how long. Because they wear him down. They wear him down. But it's also the militarizing of our educational system. All three of them, financialized, privatized, and they militarized. So that young folk going to school already have a military experience. Yes, and getting through the security. And all of the police and so forth. Why? Because there is too much cruelty, too much ugly behavior in too many of our schools. No doubt about that. And very much because of what I was talking about before, when you're socially neglected, economically abandoned, your parents hardly have jobs with a living wage. You're bombarded with TV every day, projecting the good life in materialistic form. Our young folk go in just as bundles of pleasure to be consumers and end up plugged into the lower rungs of the labor force with very little sense of what real education is. Education is not the same as schooling. And we want every child educated, not just schooled. And that's another reason why the music is so weak. I spend a lot of time in the studio, I've been blessed to work with hip-hop artists, of course. Because it's not just Gucci and others, but more technique. See, he's going to be in New York this coming week with Brother Ali. We're both of them in the studio. So many others, I tell them. I said, you know, it's very interesting to me that your generation has not generated groups that can sing in harmony. Isn't that interesting? Even between the Delphonics and the Atlantic Star and the others. But this generation is just one ego with one microphone, spinning there, talking. Now you can be a lyrical genius like Jay-Z or Kanye West and get away with it. Or Lamar or somebody. But when you learn how to listen to somebody else's voice, not their echo, and then produce a performance with your voice blending with other voices, that's a faculty of receptivity that comes from education. That's not just egoistic, it's not just individualistic. Y'all heard the escort?
Yeah.
Come on, Broadway.
Yeah.
Look over your shoulder. You'll find me. Could the brothers harmonize or what? Could the brothers sing in tune or what? They listened to each other. They had timing. They got it from the emotion. They got it from Sylvia Robinson. They got it from Ray Goodman and Brown. They learned how to harmonize. That was a moment in black life where we had a weak consciousness. So it wasn't just a matter of one little ego making all the noise, being center stage. But you bring them all in together. There's no Luther Vandross without his background. He ain't that much without Linda, but he's a whole lot with Linda. Because of call and response, it was a communal production and performance where a we consciousness, they want our children in the schooling process and outsourcing, even when they come out, to be so isolated egos, they can't connect, they can't relate, they can't be tender, they can't be gentle, they can't afford somebody else. It's all about them. And this is true not just for black kids, this is true for all of the precious children in this society. That's part of the spiritual blackout that's taking place that needs to be called into question. Thank God for Pop, thank God for you all, thank God for Bethany, God for spirit, and God for
wake up, Dr. Cornel West. Extraordinary mind, he is placing it at the people of this culture. And we are indebted to him for coming tonight. The way we're going to proceed now, we need for Larry to dismiss us with a word, and we'll have him cast the press out, and then we'll go home safe. But let me say, how many of you, I won't say like jazz, how many of you love jazz? In this sanctuary at 6 p.m. Saturday evening, you will get live jazz, okay? You come as long as you dress in a non-provocative way. You can come with me, all right? So keep in mind that 9 o'clock Saturday morning, we're going to work. Youth Symphony, NJSO is going to be at 2 o'clock. If you want to listen to some good old music. But we're going to break it up and sit with some serious jazz. So come out and meet with us that evening. And now, again, let's welcome to the podium the leader.
Brothers and sisters,
Let us give Dr. West another round of applause. Tonight, as has been alluded to by Dr. West, that tonight was the kickoff drive for our 2014 membership drive in the People's Organization for Progress. So I invite all of you to join the People's Organization for Progress. You can be a member of the People's Organization for Progress, even if you're a member of five or six other organizations. I'm also a member of the NAACP, a member of various other associations, and I'm also a member of the People's Organization for Progress. Our organization was founded 33 years ago, and we're still here, I'm glad to say. 33 years later, we are a metropolitan-wide organization. We started out as a small collective here in Newark, and now we have 11 branches throughout New Jersey, New York City, and we have a branch in North Carolina. Let me just, if you would give me just a few more minutes, so that you can better able to understand what you would be joining if you join the People's Organization for Progress, let me share three brief documents with you. First of all, the preamble to our Constitution. It says, we, the members of the People's Organization for Progress, have founded this association in which we live. We, the members of the People's Organization for Progress, have founded this association in the society in which we live. It is our desire to build a more just social order. Our primary goal is nothing less than the complete elimination of poverty, all forms of social, racial, and economic exploitation, oppression, degradation, human misery, suffering, and injustice. We shall unify and organize working, poor, and progressive people and strive to foster cooperation, self-reliance, and a militant fighting spirit among them. We shall build our organization so that it may become a viable political vehicle for the oppressed and a significant force for progressive politics. We shall work to unite the greater progressive community, increase its ranks, and build a broad mass movement at the local level, which will be an integral part of the national and worldwide struggle for social and economic justice. Our concern is not only for society as a whole, but for the individual as well. We seek not only social transformation, but the transformation of the individual through involvement in the struggle for human liberation. We believe that in order for the struggle to transform society to succeed, it must be carried out and supported by people imbued with revolutionary values. We want to make the individual socially aware and concerned, more responsible and compassionate, committed and active in the struggle for social change. The aims and purposes of the People's Organization for Progress: to educate people about the relevant social, economic, and political issues, to continuously organize and mobilize the grassroots community so that it can effectively solve its problems and fight for its needs, to improve the social and economic conditions in our community, to work for the total elimination of racism and sexism, to further develop and increase the political power of working and poor people, to strive for a more just and equitable distribution of wealth in our society, to serve as an advocate of human and civil rights, to support the struggles of people at home and abroad against oppression and exploitation, to promote world peace, to build unity with other organizations and individuals whose goals are similar to our own. And lastly, the core demands of the People's Organization for Progress. We demand reparations for the descendants of Africans enslaved in America. We want full and just compensation to all African Americans for the centuries of brutalization and forced labor that their ancestors were made to endure. We demand an end to police brutality and demand the establishment of an elected civilian police review board with subpoena and prosecutorial powers over all police forces at all levels in the United States. We demand an immediate end to all racial inequality and racial discrimination in all areas of life in the United States. We demand the immediate creation of jobs programs that will eliminate unemployment and provide jobs and wages for every person that is willing and able to work. We demand a guaranteed minimum income for all people of working age that will allow them to adequately support themselves and their families and eliminate poverty and hunger in this country. We demand the establishment of a system of universal free health care in the United States, which will enable all people to receive adequate and proper medical and dental care at all times. We demand the establishment of a system of free higher education that will enable all students to attend colleges and universities free of charge. We demand that the federal government fully subsidize all child care programs so that working parents will no longer have to pay for this service. We demand the abolition of the death penalty in the United States. We demand adequate food, clothing, housing, employment, health care, education, legal representation, recreation, and culture for every person in the United States. These are the core demands of the People's Organization. So I invite you all to join our organization. We meet every Thursday at the Abyssinian Baptist Church, 224 West King Street. We're meeting tomorrow night, and as I said, tomorrow night we're going to commemorate the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King by discussing the sixth chapter from his book, Where Do We Go From Here? Chaos or Community, that chapter entitled The World House. And we also invite you to our next forum, will be April 10th. Junius Williams will be our guest speaker. He will be discussing his recently published book, The Unfinished Agenda, which is a history of politics here in Newark, New Jersey. So brothers and sisters, thank you all. Deacon Cosby. Deacon Cosby is going to close us out in prayer. Thank you very much, brothers and sisters.
We'd like to thank all of you for coming and listening, and thank you for your spirit. What a friend we have in Jesus. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you. Thank you for these two gentlemen. Thank you for their voices. Thank you for their freedom fighting. Thank you for their gifts, Lord. Lord, we just know that you're the Alpha and the Omega. We know that you're the beginning and you're the end. So, Lord, we ask you for traveling with us, for those who have come. Give them the spirit to go home, to think about what they have heard, Lord, and put it into action. Because we all need the voices. We all need you, Lord. We know that you will be with us and you will never leave us alone. So we thank you for this night. In the sweet, precious name of Jesus, we pray.